We're six paragraphs in, and it knows about this point I've covered the first sentence of this initial paragraph. Now it's time to talk about this second sentence of the lead, even more surprising to the researchers of the fact that they spoke English. And it completely ignored the speaking English part until it got to the part of the news article where that comes in, and now it's talking about it, which is the kind of thing that these kinds of systems would have real trouble doing.
I've known journalists who can't write that well.
That ties into something that I think is kind of fundamental to the way that people think about AI. Like, we used to think that you had to be really clever to be good at chess, and if you could play chess, then you were a real intelligence. You had to be. And then we realized that, like, playing chess to a superhuman level doesn't require something that we would call intelligence. And it's slightly unsettling to find that, like, writing coherent and plausible news prose apparently also doesn't require general intelligence. Like, if you just learn the statistical relationships between words, but do that really, really well, that seems to be enough.
I mean, obviously, any journalist would say that the truth is kind of important in this as well. But yeah, to make it sound plausible, you're absolutely right.
Right. So there's definitely questions about, like, directing this towards producing a specific article that is correct. But just the generating of the prose itself apparently requires less, like, philosophical sophistication than we thought. Than many thought, anyway. I think 10 years ago, people would have a really hard time believing that something that's just learning from data and learning these relative probabilities could produce something this coherent.
You would expect it to have all sorts of conditions and formula and kind of algorithms saying...
And encoded. You would look at this and say, oh, this must have like a database of names and countries and locations and cities and everything else, because it's using that information. But it turns out all of that is already represented in the data set, because we're talking about all these things. Here's a recipe for some kind of peppermint chocolate cake, and it's got a bunch of different completions. So it can just spit these out arbitrarily. So you know those recipe blogs where, like, you Google the recipe for something and you go to the blog and there's like seven paragraphs of, like, my mother used to make this for me back in our home in Indiana. I always remember sitting out on the porch with my dog. He used to, you know. The important thing is I had an onion on my belt, which was the style at the time. And it's doing that. It's like talking about different...
Backstory.
Yeah, just backstory and...
I wonder if anyone's tried to make any of these recipes.
Yeah, it's dangerous. This one.
Cool.
So this is a recipe for meringue cookies. 1¾ cups butter softened, 1 cup of sugar, an egg yolk, 3 tea of heavy cream. It's just capital T. What unit is that? 3 tons heavy cream. That's usually a lowercase T. I don't know what that is. 3 tons of heavy cream, let's say. 3½ to 4 cups of flour, a pinch of salt, peppermint Jojo topping, which, like, I have no idea what that is, but peppermint Jojo's is mentioned in the prompt, so... 1¼ cups powdered sugar, 1 cup of chopped pecans, 1/2 cup finely chopped mint leaves, 1/2 cup chopped fresh mint, 1/2 sheet. So it's like, it doesn't quite make sense, but it's right on the edge of making sense. Like, we have 1/2 cup of chopped mint leaves, and then also 1/2 cup of chopped fresh mint.
Are these potentially cherry-picked out of a huge number of horrendous
Right,
outputs?
Yes. So these ones specifically are not. So the unicorn one, and this is something that I like, and it's standard practice, but I like this. The unicorn one, it says, they specifically said, right, now we're going to make a sample for the paper. They made 10 of them, and they picked the one they liked, which was this one. But for the recipes here, these are not cherry-picked at all. That's why they're showing 6. They've just gone, this is the first 6 that we generated, and here they are. And so that gives you a better idea of the general quality of what it's putting out. They're all fairly sensible. Like, look at this one, man. This one comes in and says, I do not substitute it with something else, blah, blah, blah. And then, like this. I don't know if that is,
social
like,
media.
Here's an image, or, yeah, please like this on Facebook. And then it goes on, I found this really cute card with cute little kittens on, and then the sample's cut off. So it's just like, next post in the blog, or, you know. This is why GPT-2 is so cool to me. Let's see, the first thing they tested on is a children's book test, where this is, I think it's like a closed thing, where you just have a data set with some children's books, and then you, like, remove one word, and then the system has to predict which of the words is the correct Like you give it 10 words that it might be or something like that, and it has to pick what word fits in this space. So that's standard kind of language model type task. The one thing that they did have to do is they had to run analysis to check about overlap, and it turns out that one of the children's books is The Jungle Book by Rudyard Kipling, which was actually in its entirety was in the data set that they trained the thing on, so it just knew that one. So then they threw that out, because obviously that's not fair if you've already seen the entire book before. And its performance on that was good. By the time it gets up to the very large scale models, it's scoring, 89%, where humans tend to get like 90, 92, 93%. It's like nearly at human level for guessing one missing word from a sentence in a children's book. Pretty good. Lambada is designed to test long-range dependencies, which is what I've been talking about a lot. The task is to predict the final word of sentences which require at least 50 tokens of context for a human to successfully predict. So like 50 words is a pretty long sentence. And so this kind of long-term dependency thing is a standard way of testing language models. And it ends up with an accuracy of 63%, which is an improvement over state-of-the-art by 4%. So it's state-of-the-art on Lambada without being specifically trained on that, just running in general. The Vinograd schema, I don't know if it's Vinograd, who knows? Maybe it's somebody's name, whatever. This is about resolving ambiguities, which is really especially important in translation tasks and things like that. It's very easy for sentences to be ambiguous in a way that makes translating them very difficult or even impossible. And I have I have an example of this. Check this out. So consider a sentence like, the chicken didn't cross the road because it was too blank. Okay, and then we can consider different versions of this sentence. Suppose that this is wide. Chicken didn't cross the road because it was too wide, right? That's like one possible completion for this. Or you might say, the chicken didn't cross the road because it was too scared. Another perfectly sensible sentence. Then the question is, it. In one of these, it is referring to the chicken, and in one of them, it is referring to the road.
Can I throw a third in?
Sure.
Stormy.
Stormy. Oh, yeah, all right, that's a good one. So stormy means it is actually neither of the things in the sentence. The other one that's fun is something like busy, right? Is it a busy road, or did the chicken just have better things to do than crossing the road? We don't know. I mean, like, I would say probably the road, but this could be a children's book, right? We are running this thing on children's books. The rabbit was too busy. It was late for an important date. Why can't the chicken be busy? So the point is, suppose we're trying to translate this into a language that genders everything, as many languages do, and maybe chicken is like a masculine noun and road is a feminine noun, and it has to know what it's about, right? Is this il or el or whatever? So the idea of this benchmark is measuring how well it can resolve ambiguities. Because if this says wide, if you're trying to do translation the old-fashioned way, where you're like parsing trees and looking things up in dictionaries and stuff like that, this kind of sentence is a hell nightmare, because you don't know. I mean, you just don't know. The information is not really present in the text. It's not present grammatically. It's present in your understanding of the world and chickens and roads, right? So translating this, if this was too wide, and you translate it into something which is the equivalent of the English sentence, the chicken didn't cross the road because the chicken was too wide, you've screwed up, right? That's a bad translation. But at the same time, like, there's nothing in the sentence that tells you that it shouldn't be, right? So what you need to do is the thing that we've already seen that GPT-2 is super good at, which is pulling in knowledge of the world, like knowing that the University of La Paz is going to be near the Andes or in the Andes, right? That kind of thing. It's going to know that roads being wide is a thing, much more than chickens being wide is a thing, and so on. And that, like, roads don't get scared if it's scared. Roads are fearless. So again, on this kind of thing, it does very well. It beats the state of the art by a lot, you can see on this graph here. So the way that this graph is laid out, by the way, this is the same in all of them. This is the size of the model. They made four different sizes of model. And these are like the same sizes that previous language models were, so they were like, make sense to compare them. The previous two, the small ones, they do worse than the state of the art. But then the 762 million parameter and the 1.5 billion parameter significantly pass state of the art. They're getting like 70%.
So the state of the art is the straight line across, right?
Yes. And the thing that is also kind of fun about some of these graphs is, so some of them, the 762 million and the 1.5 billion end up doing about as well as each other, which means you've like hit the limit of, I get maybe your data set or your whatever. Whereas in this one, there's still growth, which means an even bigger model we might expect to do even better, maybe. Reading comprehension, this is another thing. You have some text, then you have to answer questions about that text, right? The thing that's fun is, how do you do this without modifying your model that's just a generative model? So this is where we start getting into these.
So that's you, by the time it's read it, it's modified itself based upon what you've given it to read. Is that what you mean?
No, what I mean is the way that GPT-2 works is you give it the sequence of tokens and it gives you a probability distribution for the next token. And so the like type signature of that is totally fine with if you're trying to fill in a missing word. Or I guess I don't know how they did it for these, for this test. But you have to take the challenge that you're given and try and express it in terms of this like predict the next word type setup, because otherwise you're sort of cheating, right? The whole thing is they're trying to go at this and not modify the system at all. So for reading comprehension, the way they do it is they give the thing that's to be comprehended, and then they give Q colon a question, A colon the correct answer to that question, new line, Q colon a new question. They give like three or four example questions, and then Q colon the question they actually want answered, A colon, let it generate. So they sort of prime it. I think we have some examples of this. So this is how they did the question answer thing. They gave these two paragraphs about the Olympic Games, the torch relay, moving the Olympic torch, I don't know, some news story. And then a bunch of questions, right? Question, what was the theme? Answer, one world, one dream, and so on and so on. And then at the end, question, and did they climb any mountains? And then A colon, generate me the next word. So they've used this the input text to kind of prime the model. Now we're doing question answer pairs.
This is how it works.
Right. And the interesting thing about this is it actually ends up giving kind of a better answer than the human generated answers. So the question, did they climb any mountains? The responses they got from humans were unknown, yes, yes, and yes, because they did climb mountains. But GPT-2, their answer is Everest. So GPT-2's answer is actually kind of better than the humans. The humans just said, yes, they did. And the machine learning system has named the mountain that they climbed. So I don't know if that counts as not quite understanding the question, or if that counts as actually providing a high quality answer. It's up for debate. Because it has this ability with attention to do the long range, it has to look back past all of the previous questions to the actual paragraph and find the relevant information, and it can do it. And it performs reasonably well at that. But the thing I love about that is that they have to like come up with tricks to get it to actually do the task that they're trying to get it to do. So the summarization one is brilliant. I love the way they did this with the summarization. See if you can guess how they did this, right? You want to get a summary of a piece of text. How do you get that given a huge data set of Reddit content? So what you do is you write the whole long piece of text and then you put like a new line and then you put TLDR. Too long, didn't read. In this data set, there will be thousands and thousands of examples of long pieces of text followed by a short summary of that text. And in the middle is this string TLDR. I would love to have been in the room when they thought of that. So yeah, it's really, really cool, really powerful technology. I like it a lot.
So an executable binary. The net effect of slotting that T diagram against here slightly downwards is to show you that the C you've written gets converted into binary, and the net output from this process, it produces out a program that you probably store in a file.